And welcome to Running. I'm tonight's host, Ellen Lockyer. This is the first of three nights, and tonight we'll meet candidates running for House seats 7 through 12, as well as Senate seats D and F. Here to kick off the night are Republican candidates vying for Senate seat D, Lynn Gaddis and David Wilson. Hi, thanks for being with us. And during this segment, candidates will have the chance to make an opening and closing statement. I'll ask them a series of questions. And later in the program, they will have the opportunity to ask questions of each other. The questions and the answers are timed. Throughout the evening, you'll also hear brief statements from candidates running for uncontested seats. Let's get started. Ms. Gaddis, your opening statement, please.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here. My name is Lynn Gaddis, and I was raised in the interior of Alaska by homesteaders. And I was brought up that hard work pays off. And I'll tell you what, this state of ours, it's so very, very important right now that we do the right thing. We're in historical times, and these times that we do the right thing, we do it right for all Alaskans so that they can have the same opportunity that I grew up. And that's why I'm running for Senate seat D, for that opportunity to help my fellow Alaskans out. So thank you for having me.
Thank you. And Mr. Wilson, your opening statement, please.
Yes, I've come to the state in 99. My entire adult life has been here in Alaska. I came to go to school at Alaska Pacific University, where I've met my wife, who's a lifelong Alaskan, grew up on the Yukon River. I've graduated with degrees in education psychology and an MBA in health service administration. And I feel that I'm more of a motivated, personable business professional with a lot of diverse education and experience, which I think would be a benefit for the state and for the constituents of Senate District D. I'm currently serving as a councilman for the city of Wasilla, and I am a director of a local domestic violence sexual assault shelter out in the valley. And from that, I'm also served as chairperson of the Board of Ethics, and I'm currently serving the MATSU Transportation Advisory Board.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, I'll start off with some questions for the candidates, starting with Representative Gaddis. The fiscal plan, obviously, it did not sit well with many of our legislators. What are your objections to Governor Walker's fiscal plan? And is there any leeway where you would find some things you'd agree with?
So, Ellen, I've been pretty clear. I've been pretty clear on my record. I've been clear that when we had good times, we grew our budget. When we have lean times where we are right now, we need to make it leaner. You know, when I go down this in the grocery store, I have my friends say, you know what, if you need some help, we will help you. We've had our husbands that have been furloughed. Housewives from Wasilla have said, we know what it takes to run a family budget. And what we have to do, if we don't have the money, we have to make the budget smaller. So that was my biggest objection to throwing any other revenues, also known as taxes, in. We need to make the budget smaller.
Okay, you're hearing cutting the budget. Mr. Wilson, what are you hearing? How would you address the governor's fiscal plan if elected?
If elected, first, pay some of those debt obligations that he's neglected. The $52 million from the MATSU borough that was cut is really needed for those schools. We have to have a smaller, leaner size of government and cut some of those non-essential government services that are not constitutionally mandated to fund.
Okay, short and sweet. Well, Mr. Wilson, what were some of those non-essential government services? I mean, going in, if you were elected, how would you revise the budget next session?
Going in to look at the budget for next session, we need to look at some of those past bills that we funded in the past. We need to look at, we're one of the few states that have opted to pay for every single Medicaid function, and some of those we just can't afford to do anymore. We don't have the luxury to afford to pay for those services. And looking at some consolidation of services as well.
Okay, consolidation of services. Representative Gaddis, going in next session, should you be elected, how would you make revisions to the budget after this session?
So I certainly have an advantage over my opponent, having sat on finance for the last couple of years. And so I've been able to dig through the budget. And what I would do, I literally, the folks in our district are saying, go in and swashbuckle. Go in and make those cuts. You know, don't just cut a few on the fringes at this. We have formula programs that are growing and growing and growing. So it's time. We literally have to get into it, make statute changes, and make huge changes. We've done the low-hanging fruit, and we've gone and looked at some of the smaller programs, but we, again, and I've said it over and over, we have to take a large budget, and we have to make it smaller before we start dipping into people's pockets.
Okay. My next question deals with the opioid summit that is coming up in the Valley this week on the 4th. Representative Gaddis, what can the state do? What can the legislature do to help alleviate the opioid epidemic in the state?
Well, that's a very interesting question. And so just even yesterday, I had folks stop and say, I see your sign on your car. And we moved into that very subject. And the fact that we've looked at Medicaid reform. We passed a bill this last year that dealt with some of those issues. We have to do something different. We have to, I think, recognize that we have a different culture. I've asked young people, so I don't get it. You know, why are you guys going there? We look at the prescriptions of an opioid that certainly wasn't prescribed in my younger days, and literally the culture of our young in regards to this. So yeah, I'll be going to that opioid program that Senator Sullivan is putting on, but we literally need to say, we need to acknowledge that we have a problem and all pitch in together on both sides of the aisle.
Thank you. Mr. Wilson, what are your ideas to address the opioid epidemic in the state?
We have looked at different ways of addressing. I do work for an agency that does also have a branch of substance abuse treatment program. And the way that the state has made a lot of their cuts has really affected a lot of the substance abuse programs throughout the state of Alaska. And it's limited them in terms of ways of the number of folks they can reach, the number of assessments that they can do. And we just need to go out and try to find other ways to combat this this epidemic. I, too, will be at the summit on August 4th. And we need to look at ways that we can help folks combat this addiction and trying to find ways for resiliencies to work on their strengths to help them pull through treatment and give them those additional supports.
Thank you. Now, my next question deals with education. The Senate did not override Governor Walker's vetoes dealing with the school funding formula and the school transportation funding. If you were elected, how would you address this? How would you address more funding for education in the coming session?
You know, this is a very controversial because everyone wants their kids to make sure that they have the right to education and have the good quality education. And where I see the ways that we can help increase the spending for the students is that we have over 54 school districts, and half of those school districts have less than four schools or less that they actually administer. And so, one, we have way too much money going into the administration side of education. Those dollars could be used for the actual services and the education of those children as well.
Okay. Representative Gaddis, how would you deal with more education funding?
Well, and I always, and as chair of education for my first couple of years and a school board member for the Mat-Su School District, I pride ourselves on some of the huge changes that we made as school board members in the Mat-Su. And so even my colleagues will say, we'll tout the mighty Mat-Su. So how would I make those mighty Mat-Su changes statewide? We have to roll back some of the regulations that we legislators have put in for superintendents, for school teachers. One of those things that you look at first in, last out, 10-year programs, opportunities for people to really do good work. So there are statute changes, and I would look at those statute changes that forces people to spend in a certain way.
Okay. Now it's time for the candidates to ask each other questions, and I'll start with Representative Gaddis. Your turn to ask Mr. Wilson a question, please.
Okay, well, he's a hard person to attack because he's really run a pretty clean campaign. But one of the questions that I found intriguing, and so I'll ask this, is while on the city council, when I was part of this, I fully admit, when we had a tax, a sales tax, And the sales tax was to fund a library, to put skin in the game for the library. And we had a sunset date. And Mr. Wilson, you voted not to sunset it, but to keep it on. How do you reconcile that with the citizens when they voted to sunset a sales tax?
So the sales tax still had the sunset date on it, and it wasn't to a vote to extend that. And I voted to allow that to go to the ballot instead of voting for the tax itself. And so that was the vote that we allowed, because I felt that the constituents of the city of Wasilla should make that decision whether or not they would like to continue to have a 3% sales tax. So the tax was going to end, and then the voters were going to vote whether or not that tax was going to be. And that's something that I felt that the voters of the city of Wasilla should make that decision, and not the government should not just impose a sales tax just arbitrarily upon them.
Okay. Representative Gaddis, your response?
Well, my response is, you obviously know that clearly went down in flames, and the voters said, when we put a sunset on there, that's what we mean. We wanted it to sunset. So we all learned a lot from there. But when our voters state that you can have a tax for a specific thing, we'll let you do it. But when we get to that, when we've made that $15 million, then we're done. And so please don't extend something. So I think the voters spoke on that. So we learned a lot. Thanks.
Mr. Wilson, your question for Representative Gaddis, please.
Yes, Ms. Gaddis, would you sponsor or support a bill this upcoming session for term limits for Alaska State legislators, sort of the why and why not?
It's an interesting question. I see the pros and cons, and I think it's a really good question. I would not sponsor it, and here's what it is. You and I are sitting here right now on a term limits type situation. The voters of Senate District D will determine whether I should have term limits, whether my two terms as state representative are enough, and that they want somebody new. So I won't be sponsoring or voting for term limits.
Your response, please, Mr. Wilson?
I just feel that term limits sometimes create, our elected officials worrying about their next elections instead of conducting the business of the people. You know, with new limits ideas, it limits the new ideas or creativity, and it creates more temptation for corruption for our legislators, since they're sequestered in Juneau with lobbyists.
Okay. Well, I'm here with the two candidates for Senate D, Representative Lynn Gaddis and David Wilson. And it's your turn, I believe, Representative Gaddis, to ask Mr. Wilson a question.
Well, he's been a pretty easy guy to work with over the time. And my question, and I've asked this of him before, is in regards to business. So I truly think at these historical times, when we need to pivot government to the private place, what do you bring to the table business-wise that can help us get to that point? So how can we take things that we're doing in government and pivot them over to business with, essentially, you operate a nonprofit, and that kind of flies in the face of business?
So I work in the nonprofit sector because I enjoy helping folks, and that's what I pride myself upon, is how can I do the most good for my community and folks. I do have a business background. I feel that government should learn from business and not have sort of expenditures to oversee the revenues that they're coming in with. For business development, you know, it's the state's job to help businesses to grow and succeed in Alaska by not having overburdensome regulations for our businesses, so they can thrive and survive. We know when contractors and developers have to go and put years and years of getting permitting, that's a lot of money and jobs that just can't be developed in the state. And having having the ability and flexibility to do that on a more expedited schedule will help our state and help our local economies grow.
Ms. Gaddis, your response, please.
I couldn't disagree with him more as far as burdensome or overburdensome regulation. And certainly that's a concern by many business people that, you know, government, get the heck out of our way. You know, let us be in business. So as a small business person, I agree with him wholeheartedly. Get the government out of our way so we can do our business. So thanks.
Okay, Mr. Wilson, your question next for Mrs. Gaddis, please. Ms. Gaddis.
Thank you. So my background is I work with a lot of offenders of crimes of such, and trying to, on the educational rehabilitation side of things. You voted in favor of SB 91, the Alaska Justice Reform Bill. Knowing some of the outcomes and loopholes for the offenders and the lessened consequences for DUI and some of the violent offenders, would you still support the bill or make any upcoming changes in this next session?
I may make some upcoming changes, but I still would support the bill. And when I've talked to folks that are just emotional about this, as we sit there and talk about it, what they all agree is what we're doing now is not working. And some folks would refer to it as that hug a thug bill or whatever. But when they circle back around, when you take an addict and you put an addict in jail and then they don't have a job and you let them out, what do you think the addict's going to do? Again, continue robbing. And that's one of the big problems that we have in the Mat-Su is we have a real huge theft problem by addicts. So we got to do something different. And that's why I voted for it. That's why I went out to the correctional farm the other day with the commissioner. We got to do something different. And so that's what I'm for.
Okay, thank you. Your response, please, Mr. Wilson.
You know, I'm all about we need to have some type of criminal justice reform in the state, or we have way too much of a high recidivism rate of our offenders going back into jail. But I think this bill has a lot of issues for even businesses where your first two thefts under 250, you're not looking at any jail time. And so, or the DUIs that it allows those folks off. And it doesn't have the consequences, and the bill really neglects the victims of crime. And it doesn't really help those folks. It doesn't really help just the common Alaskans. I mean, we need something, and I agree that, you know, we do need to fix something with the substance abuse issues and have less barriers for folks when they come out of jails and come out of the correctional institutions, that they can be given the tools to succeed on their own. But I don't think this bill is the right bill at this time.
You need to wrap that up. Okay, thank you. And this brings me to my next question. The Palmer Correctional Center, we just got notice last week that it will be shutting down by November. And apparently that is one of the fallouts of the severe budget cuts. Ms. Gaddis, what else are you hearing in your district? What are the impacts of the recent round of budget cuts in your district? What other state services that won't be there for people?
So it certainly seems that the Mat-Su took a larger proportion of budget cuts, and not that I'm implying that the governor might have looked specifically at the Mat-Su, but it certainly looks that way. Let's just say it there. The budget cuts, there are some things that just absolutely make no sense. And I tell you what, it's a very small amount, but it's punitive. When you look at, I'm a big snow machiner, so I'm paying my registration fees for a snow machine so that I can get trails groomed and things like that. And then to take the $250,000, put it in the general fund, we've paid for that for trails. So it makes no sense to tick off a large portion of sports people and snow machiners to do that when we paid for that to happen. So I'm going to hopefully run a bill that keeps designated funds where it was meant to be, funds that user fees that we paid.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Wilson, what are you hearing in your district about the impacts of the budget cuts?
I agree with Ms. Gaddis about the user fees for the snow machiners. I love going out and riding in the winter. But also the safety of the road systems, the KGB upgrades have been cut out of the budget as well. I mean, that's a huge safety corridor that we have lots of deaths and accidents, severe accidents, and that road does need to be upgraded and to the safety standards. We knew that minimum was going to be closing at PCC, but also the school bonds package that's going to devastate. And then locally, you know, we got a letter from the borough for the grants that they give to local municipalities, and they're looking at cutting those. The borough funded $100,000 for law office for drug enforcement officers for the cities of Palmer and Wasilla to help the troopers, and that now is at risk of being cut.
Okay, thank you. My next question would be just to Mr. Wilson. What are your ideas for diversifying the state's economy beyond oil? I mean, other than oil.
You know, we have that hot topic of the LNG, you know, debate, and you know, we need that project is a good project. You know, we're looking at the rail spur, the Point McKenzie access. does need to be have another deep port access for the shipping lanes other than Anchorage, so we don't have to continue to dredge the mud and sand out of the ports. Really, it's going to be more on the infrastructural nature of trying to get goods and services to the folks of Alaska more efficiently.
Okay. Ms. Gaddis, how about you? Any ideas for diversification?
Sure I do, and I'll piggyback on my opponent here, and that is we're a resource development state. We are. We can diversify, and we're doing good things in tourism and some of these niche markets, but that's not paying the bills. And at the end of the day, we are a large state with some really great resources, and we have to be able to look at those and develop them. Again, the rail extension or the rail spur, there's some resources that we need to mine. We need to get people out mining, people out digging, people drilling, and that is what we need to be doing as a resource development state. We have great parks, but we don't need to turn the state into a park.
Okay, and my next question would be addressed to you, Representative Gaddis. The rail spur to from Port McKenzie to Houston has been under construction for some time. There's a lot of delays, but as far as I know, the Mat-Su borough needs $200 million to complete it. The state does not have the money. How would you suggest the borough address this the need for the rail spur and how to pay for it?
Well, it's a borough and state issue because it, again, it goes back to our resource development. And I think there's a couple of different ways. I think there's many different ways, and that is folks that want to do joint partnerships, that want to help finish that rail extension, those same very folks that either are mining the resources or receiving the resources, I think that getting them all together and having them go hand in hand, it's a joint benefit to all of them. So I think that that's where we go forward next, getting them all together and say, hey, you guys, you know, this is what we got to do. Alaskans, join together and make this work.
Okay. Mr. Wilson, ideas as to how to get that rail spur going?
I agree. You know, the state shouldn't be the sole entity. The Alaska Railroad is a sort of a private corporation that's help funded by the state. But we do need to get other partners and investments going with that. I mean, it's a huge, huge quantity of coal's coming back, markets, and so trying to get some of these other investors and other partners that will benefit from that rail spur to help invest in that would be a huge benefit as well.
And would the, Mr. Wilson, would the state's recent Moody credit rating downgrade, would that hurt the chances of getting private investment in the railroad spur?
I think our credit rating, it definitely was a blow to some of our investors and sort of the interest rates that possibly will be going up. But yes, it definitely did hurt, but I feel that Alaska's investment in Alaska and investments by investors into Alaska's infrastructures and into our natural resources is still a good sound investment to make.
Representative Gaddis, how do you feel about the Moody's downgrade?
Well, and I think the bottom line is, if business can come here and make money, they're going to come here and make money. And I don't think that we need to have, I think further struggles show that the state is going through a huge resettling and restructuring. But I have a colleague that says, we have the rocks. And so if we have the rocks and they're saleable and a business can make money, they're going to come here and they're going to make money.
Okay. Another question I have, if you were to be elected to Senate D, Charlie Huggins left some pretty big shoes to fill. What would your strategy be to keep that big old Valley coalition together?
So interesting, because I recorded a commercial that's not even out yet, so I hope that there's no spies in there. But seriously, I talked about that in my commercial, that they are big boots to fill with smaller shoes. But that being said, we have a Valley delegation that typically philosophically thinks the same way, walks the same way. And, you know, we'll gather together, and it's been great being back. Our constituents are telling us the same things that we intrinsically know, and we'll get together after the elections, and we'll figure out what the next step is.
Thank you. Mr. Wilson, should you be elected to Senate D, how would you proceed with the Valley Coalition, getting them working in tandem?
You know, I think that the Valet Coalition has done a good job in some of the districts of just sitting down and meeting with the folks and meeting with their constituents. And I would like to continue and honor that. I've been out meeting with a lot of different folks in the community and different community groups. And, you know, it's amazing that they all are dealing with similar issues and similar barriers to have a healthy and strong community. And win or lose this election, I still plan to work with those community groups and to help them address some of those issues and then work with our elected officials in terms of trying to find solutions to those problems.
Well, it looks like our time here has flown by, and we're ready for closing statements. Representative Gaddis, your closing statement, please.
Thank you. And I just want to say that I'd like to continue representing the Mat-Su area, specifically Senate District D, which includes Point McKenzie, Big Lake, Wasilla, Meadow Lakes. And I'd like to continue bringing those conservative values, cutting the budget, doing the things that my constituents have asked me to do, and I've been stalwart in doing that. So please, I'd be humbled if you'd vote for me August 16th or from now onward, since early voting is available, Lynn Gaddis for Senate District D. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Wilson, your closing statement, please.
You know, I did say I am a personable professional. I prefer folks to come to me. I prefer going out in the community. I'm a very involved community member. I feel that I have expertise and diverse experience to bring a lot of great strength and skills to the state of Alaska. And, you know, I feel that it's time for some changes and some initial attitudes. And so I hope to earn the trust of the voters. And please vote for me August 16th, as Ms. Gaddis stated, or just give me a call or look me up on the Facebook or my website, davidwilsonforsenate.com.
Okay, thank you, David Wilson. Lynn Gaddis, thank you both for coming on the show and getting us off to a great start for running. For those of you just tuning in, we've just talked with the candidates for Senate Seat D, Lynn Gaddis and David Wilson. Up next, candidate for House Seat 8. I'm here with Mike Alexander, the Republican candidate for House Seat 8, representing the Palmer area. His opponent, Representative Mark Newman, was invited but is unable to be here tonight. So, Mr. Alexander, let's start with your opening statement, please.
Thank you. My name is Mike Alexander. I'm 68 years old now. I'm a retired state worker. I spent 11 years at the state as a registered nurse. I've worked Department of Corrections and API. And the reason I got into this race, I wanted to make sure that we went on with these budget cuts without making someone bleed necessarily, but to get them down to a sustainable level, get rid of the waste, and that was why I stepped in this. And that was my main objection to Mr. Newman. I just didn't feel we were getting there quick enough.
You didn't feel there was enough budget cuts coming?
Just, you know, wasteful stuff especially, and not and when there was last year, like for instance, we had our snow wasn't plowed out on the road because there was a 5% cut. And I thought, surely we can do better than that. We should have services that are mandatory. I mean, kind of a, yeah, we're not going to cut this till the very last instant, you know. And I didn't feel they were getting with it very well. And then the thing that Mr. Newman did was when they went to Juneau here to override the governor's veto or do something with it, they just sat there and did nothing.
Okay.
And I really, that put me in the thing where I thought, you know, I really need to do something about this.
Okay, so let's get to some questions. So
sure.
In your own words, are you satisfied with the legislative action on the fiscal plan this past session?
You know, I really wasn't. We were out of state for quite a bit, and I came back, and I left, well, sure, it'll be fine. You know, the guys they did a great job the year before, I thought, considering, you know, and they took a lot of the easy stuff. We knew they would do that. And kind of let everybody ease into realize there's going to be more austerity due in the state. And I thought they'd do a fine job this year. And I came back and I found that, you know, they really hadn't cut the budget. They were touting a $4.3 billion number, but in actuality, when the add-ons and the, I guess you're going to call them just bookkeeping maneuvers, right? Anyway, at that time, I thought that, you know, it came out to be almost what it was last year, and I thought you didn't really do anything.
So, Mr. Newman is the co-chair of the House Finance, so you're tackling from the top. How would you, if elected, how would you revise the budget as it is now? I mean, what would you do next session to cut it further?
I believe I'd look at actually reopening some of the negotiations on state contracts for employees. I was a state employee for 10 years, and it's a nice job. There are a lot of perks in there that people in the private sector do not get. I have a lot of friends that have worked years at things. They've all taken anywhere from a 10 to 20% cut just to stay employed. And I don't think we had to be that drastic here, but at least revisit it. The step increases are a problem because that's an automatic 3% increase every year. And I enjoyed those when I was a state employee. I can't say I didn't. But those, and then I think we also need to look at what, like on education, I don't really want to cut the budgets. I want that money in the classroom. But the reputation, like we have, I think it's on Prince Wales Island, there's either two or four different school districts with a full set of administrators.
Okay.
Things like that. That's okay. What I really wanted to look at is cutting that down.
Okay, that's the education component. Let's get back to the, you have anticipated one of my questions regarding the state employee contracts. Mm-hmm. In your opinion, are they too fat, the contracts? And would you not face opposition from employees' unions before instituting
you
further
would,
cuts?
And unfortunately, I've done that before because when I left, I was no longer allowed to hold office or vote in their elections. I left the Alaska State Employees Association. And because we objected to the way the unions did it then, I know there'll be a lot of that. But I also know there's a lot of good people out there, employees that I worked with, that know that if the state's in trouble, they really need to cut down. You know, they might have to take a step back because they've all got friends that have taken wage cuts. And this year, there was a little movement. They didn't do a cost of living expense, but the step increases stayed. So it's, and we have 10,000 more employees now than we had in 2006. And that's the part that I'm going, what are these people doing? You know, and I don't know that you can't lay them all off, but surely, I mean, you know, that you would have to do, look at it realistically, are we overstaffed here and there?
Okay, so you would be in favor of reducing state employees' staff?
If we can find, you know, yeah, if it's where they are, an overabundance of employees or the jobs can be redone. Yeah, I'm not, the privatization, not so much because government does what government does and nobody else really does. You know, it's just a weird job.
Let's get back to the other part of your statement, the education cuts. Now, mm-hmm. the Senate failed to override Governor Walker's vetoes of the school funding and the school transportation funds. If you were elected, what would you do to alleviate that? What would you do to get more money back into the schools?
Well, what I would like to do is alleviate probably what I'm looking at is administration. And I base that kind of one-sidedly. I haven't studied it in depth a great deal, but what I'm looking at is the fact that I believe the administrative part of the school districts is a little overdone. And I look at API, for instance, we had about 70 people, give them 80, work the floors, and we took care of patients. We have a total of 131 people, employees at that time. And so I wondered what the other 60 were doing upstairs. And it seemed like that was a little bit overkill, you know, as far as people are there. And that's what I would want to look into is the efficiency of the operation.
Okay, the efficiency would be on your agenda.
Right.
How about, like recently, just a week or so ago, the Department of Corrections, your old employer, has announced the shutdown of Palmer Correctional Center by November. That's obviously a major fallout from some of the budget cuts this session. How would you... What else are you hearing in your district? What are you hearing about the effects of the recent budget cuts on life in the Palmer area?
Well, with my Big Lake area, what we have out on the end of KGB Road, we have the new facility. It holds more people. It's about 1,200. And what they are going to do at the Palmer facility, from what we understand, is they are going to have a training center there, which I think would be great because when I was a nurse, I would get sick call requests. And I noticed that most of these prisoners, not all of them, but a great deal of them, were functionally illiterate. I mean, I could figure it out. And that, I think, is the worst part for them when they do try to reenter society to fill out a job application or these things. Then that is where we're failing, on the prisoners, to try to keep the recidivism rate back down. And I would love to see the Palmer turned into a training facility would be really well.
Okay, it's something in favor. Plus, more education for people in incarceration
correctly placed in education. For instance, if someone's doing 99 years, I don't think they really, getting them a GED it'd be nice, but it's not imperative. But I've got a boy that's in maybe for 2-3 years for burglary, and he's there because he is having a hard time finding employment due to his lack of education and inability to fill out an employment form. That's the kind of people I would really like to reach out to, or teach them a trade.
All right, that's a good idea. How about your one of your statements is that you don't believe the state gas line is feasible. Why not? Quickly now, because we have very little time.
It just doesn't pencil out. I mean, if you do the math, maybe it will someday, but right now the rough thing on it for me is the thing that kind of knocked me back was Japanese, and from what I understand, China and Japanese are buying gas roughly for $8 a thousand. And our stuff has to sell to them, by the time we get the line done, processed, $13 to $18 a thousand for us to make it. And there's a lot of gas in the world, unfortunately. It's everywhere.
Okay.
I've got cousins that are now able to farm till their days are gone because they have a new gas well on their place.
All right. So we have time for your closing statement, please, Mr. Alexander.
Thank you. I would hope everyone would vote for me for the fact that I want to go down there and stand in on this. I don't want your PFD. I like the ICER plan where we do 50% of the permanent fund earnings for government and 50% to us for checks, because I believe that money coming to the populace is better well spent, because it's worth $1.40 in the economy. $1 to the government is worth 65 cents. So that is my whole thing, and I hope you all would come out and vote for me, because our current representative right now has never voted for a balanced budget. I don't think he knows what it's about. I wished he did.
Thank you.
I wouldn't be doing this.
Thank you, Mr. Alexander.
Thank you.
For participating in tonight's show. And for those of you watching at home, you've just heard from the Republican candidate vying for House Seat 8. Our incumbent, Mark Newman, was not able to be here tonight. So we're going to take a short break. And up next, I'll be joined by Jim Culver and George Rauscher running for House Seat 9. I'm Ellen Lockyer. Stay tuned.